Good morning, guys and gals. I'm Pal, and welcome back to Pikmin 2. Yesterday, we beat, after a long and arduous battle, honestly, it was a battle of attrition by that point. We defeated the Water Wraith. And in fact, before we jump into the new area which we unlocked, because we left Louis behind. Somehow he fell out of the ship or just didn't get in it in the first place, and we left him behind. So we're back here to both to get treasure and to get Louis. But I would like to check out two of the enemies that we encountered last episode, because they're both quite interesting. First, we're with the Bulbman. Bulbman. Pikmin family. This loathsome creature is in fact a parasitic form of Pikmin that has infected a bulb orb. Unlike Pikmin that nest in Pikmin onions, this parasitic relative spends its life inside the body of a host, usually a bulb orb. Juveniles fall in line and mimic the actions of their parent until maturing to full independence. By burying its root-like limbs into the nervous system of the host, Bulborb, and infusing it with natural hormonal excretions, the Bulbman is able to control virtually all of the host's bodily functions. However, the host's ferocious appetite seems to be impossible to suppress. And then also, when we checked this yesterday, these were not here. It didn't show the things that we haven't yet encountered, which is interesting. Now that we've completed the debt, that is there. But the Water Wraith. Also, that thing defeated 13. I thought it said defeated one Pikmin. Okay. So, Water Wraith. Amphibio sapiens. Say, what? What? Amphibio sapiens? It's in... Okay, so this thing is even creepier than I thought. This thing's in the human family. Whoa. Okay. Unknown family. All that is known about this creature stems from a few sightings deep underground. All reported sightings feature the same core set of details. A giant viscous form with a clear hazy sheen, not unlike hard candy. One theory holds that it may be the ectoplasmic incarnation of a kind of psychic phenomenon. But as usually the case with such theories, it is very difficult to prove. All witnesses report being suddenly overcome with fear upon sighting the creature, approaching a state of panic and near insanity. In fact, every report contains an inordinate amount of extremely vague details, which has led to suspicions that exhaustion and fear have caused some simple phenomenon to be viewed as a living creature. Wow. And this thing is an Amphibio sapiens. That is crazy. I don't remember reading that before. At least I don't remember picking up on the sapiens part. So that's terrifying. That enemy was absolutely terrifying. But today we're not facing a Water Wraith. Instead, we're going to start our first day in the Wistful Wild, a new area. But not quite as new as you might think. Let's land. The Wistful Wild. Mr. President, you've arrived! My scans indicate that this planet is still heavily laden with treasure! We shall make Hokotate Freight the golden indisputable king of deep space long-haul freight! Then everyone will be gaudily clad in gold, like me! No, I am unique and beautiful, yes. Olimar, I must ask that you take extreme care as to not insult or endanger our president. For now, where could Louis be? To be stuck on an uncivilized planet with no food at all. I am concerned. You must waste no time in finding him. Alright, the Wistful Wild. Now, you guys have been through this enough times to be able to assume that my next words are going to be, this area was in Pikmin 1, and it is special to me, and stuff. I don't know why I'm speaking like a comic book villain, but I don't know. And actually, you'd be right. This area is from Pikmin 1. What am I taking here? 20? 15. 15 should do. This is from Pikmin 1, but it's actually from Pikmin 1 twice. Why am I taking reds? Am I taking reds? I don't think I'm taking reds. I'm taking... what am I taking? I'll take yellows. I'll take some more yellows. Sure, why not? We need some more yellows. So what was I saying? Oh yeah, this area is indeed from Pikmin 1. The area that we landed in is the final trial. In fact, this area, the Wistful Wild, is split up into two main segments, one of which is the final trial, which is what I'm looking at now, from this area onward to here, the other end of the Wistful Wild. That is the final trial from Pikmin 1, and then over here is actually the impact site, also from Pikmin 1. And they're very clearly divided. Like, there is a line that you can draw right there and drag it all the way over here, and it separates the areas rather nicely. Now, it's kind of odd because most of the time, an area is one area, you know? Like, the distant spring. Also, I need to be careful because there's a Gatling grunk in this area that wanders around, so I need to listen for it. It's grunking. But what was I saying? Yeah, usually it's like, oh, this is the distant spring, so you can know exactly what parts are from what area of distant spring, because it's one place. But since this is multiple places at the same time, it's kind of odd, especially when you look at the world, or the Pikmin 1 map, which shows that the distant spring and, or not the distant spring, the impact site and the final trial are on opposite ends of the world map. Which is a little bit odd, I'll have to say, because they're on completely opposite ends, so how could they be right next to each other the entire time? Well, I mean, I don't want to throw plate or tectonic movement as a catch-all for explanations of why things don't line up, but really, it is. It's tectonic movement, except this time, it's kind of proven, because in Pikmin 1, oh, hello, that's a nice... That's a good reward. Awesome. Haven't gotten one of those in a while from an egg. And there's the grunking. So what was I saying? Oh yeah. This is actually proven in Pikmin 1. Kill him. Okay, cool. The area in between the impact site and the final trial is the Forest Navel. Now, the Forest Navel... Okay, let's... Please don't bug me. You know what, that's fine. I have the Plickaphone. I can deal with that. But the area in between is the Forest Navel. Now, the Forest Navel is known for being an area that is... It's almost like a cave, but it's above ground. It's like a strip mine, almost. It's dark like nighttime is at all hours of the day, but it's a completely open air. It's above ground. It also has sharp cliffs, and so what I think... is that the Forest Navel is actually on a fault line. This is backed up when you look at the actual area. It has steep sides, and the water's about to drain. It has steep sides, much like a fault would. So, what I think is that it submerged into the ground, and the two converging plates, which we would be on right now, that line I drew earlier, that's the converging plate, it buried the Forest Navel, and it was pushed somewhere underground into a cave. But what I think... Man, the Plickaphone is so nice. What I think is that it wasn't pushed under this ground. I think that it was pushed under ground elsewhere. I've looked at theories online talking about whether or not the Valley of Repose is the Forest Navel, and for the most part, there isn't any evidence to suggest this. There's just some very vague map similarities that aren't necessarily actual similarities or indications of them being the same area, but instead just, you know, like, oh look, there's a hill there and there's a hill in Forest Navel. They have to be the same now by looking at that information. And that doesn't work. But what I think was that the Emergence Cave is actually the Forest Navel, and there is some evidence to suggest this. While their layouts are almost, their differences are too vast to be able to compare them with a straight face, there is one similarity that is important to note. When I was in the Emergence Cave the first time, I mistakenly said that was the first time we ever were seeing purple Pikmin. That's wrong. In Pikmin 1, I'm trying to put yellow Pikmin away in a blue onion. In the Forest Navel, we actually see purple Pikmin, which backs up this theory. There is a certain enemy called the Puffstool, which will infect Pikmin with a spore. Very similar to Bulbman, actually. It'll infect them with a spore and take them under its control. In case you're wondering why I'm not grabbing this, by the way, this is the Doomsday apparatus. It requires 1,000 Pikmin to carry, which means I need 100 purple Pikmin, so that's not happening anytime soon. So, where was I going with this? Oh yeah, so we see the purple Pikmin, actually, in that area. And then, underground, in a very similar environment, we see purple Pikmin that look kind of similar to the Puffstool, actually. And they, just like purple Pikmin in Pikmin 1, they have no elemental immunities, and they're affected just like normal Pikmin by every single element. And they're fat and chubby. Can you die, please? They're fat and chubby, just like the Puffstool. So that's my theory. I think it's actually pretty well backed up, too. Alright. As for what I'm doing here, I'm just taking down the burgeoning spider warts, and then I'll put the yellow Pikmin that I brought over here on the electric gate. And then from there, the day will be mainly over, honestly. From there, all I need to do is just build a... Ooh, I thought I ran into that with Olimar. Is build a bridge over by where that Gatling Grink was, and then just harvest some berries, because I really need sprays badly. Okay, so I'll get the berries. I can leave this squad with Olimar, and then the president can take back the rest. Actually, no, let's do that opposite, just to save time. Alright. Now, as for why Olimar waited this long to return to the impact site, or the final trial, I keep getting those areas confused. The area where we landed is actually the arena from the final trial where we fought the... Okay, I don't hear him. Where we fought the Emperor Bulblax, which is kind of odd that he chose to land here instead of the actual area where he landed in the first place. Let's go this way. If I encounter the Gatling Grunk, I'm actually going to use a spray on him and just kill him that way. I think that'll be easier. And it doesn't make much sense why he would land in the opposite area from where he landed the first time. But actually, it kind of does when you consider that the arena is actually pretty sheltered, to be honest. Like, it's fairly sheltered from the elements. It's much better than the first place where we landed, which is over here. This is where we landed in Pikmin 1. But that area is right out in the open, but the arena is not. Alright, how am I going to kill this guy? I definitely want to kill him with a spray, but I want to kill him where the Wallywog can't join in. Come on, come on. Yeah, come to the water. No, okay, actually that'll work. There we go. I think I can kill him with this, and this way I get a spray out of it. I don't have to carry him back. Oh, and I got some pellet posies out of it. That's fine, I guess. It wasn't a total waste. Alright, so my focus for today is to actually just build this bridge and open up access. So tomorrow, I have unmitigated access to the entire region. And in case you're wondering, this area over here, this is where the impact site is. Over there is where the onions would land. There are... come on, camera. There are some stumps where there would be pellet posies. This is where we crash landed, right in this area there. And then we would build a stick type thing to climb up to get pellet posies. And then over there is where we fought the watery Gulix and the Mammuta, which are both kind of secret enemies that appear. And then in this area where the Wallywog is, there was the Pearly Clam Clam and a couple other ship parts. So it's actually, unlike the Distant Spring and other areas, this is pretty well defined. Like, it really does feel like a carbon copy of the original area that it was derived from, which is not normal for the recycles. Also, oh yeah, I forgot. Another thing, this area was also reused in Pikmin 3, I believe. If I can get a shot from this bluff, there was a river in the, is it the Garden of Hope? I think it's the Garden of Hope. Where there's a river, there's a little island to the right of the bridge that's eventually built that holds a Cupid's grenade, which is a cherry. And then there's a river which we have to build a bridge on from this side, by the way. And then there's a gate to the right of the bridge. And yeah, it's a little bit different, but it's, for the most part, the same thing, same shindig. Which is really cool. I love that they recycle these areas. Normally, I would, like, say if it were a Mario game, I would not like that. I would think it's kind of, you know, it's kind of low budget, but I think it works out really well. Because this is, as I've said many a time, this is Earth that we're on. So it would make sense that, you know, areas would be the same, because it's Earth. There are no magical properties about this, except for maybe the Water Wraith. It's just Earth hundreds or thousands of years apart because of time-space relativity. Also, this day is going rather swimmingly, I'll be honest. In fact, let's take down this Wallywog and bring it back for, and claim it for the motherland. Okay, throw some Pikmin there. I love this new Wallywog strategy. I totally forgot about it, but this is indeed the strategy I used as a child. It just works so well. Like, the thing's already dead. No Pikmin lost. No risks taken. Alright. You go on that. I won't bother fighting him. Mainly because I believe that this guy's worth it. Yeah. Distract him. Distract him. Good job. You know what? I might as well. Okay, they're gonna be thrown into the poison. Kill him, please. And kill him, please. Come on. Kill him. Nice. All right, the 10 pellet posies should be actually more valuable. So we'll take that back and start gathering Pikmin together. That was a good day. We cleared out the gate, which means that I can go to... I can actually kind of work like a pincer movement and go at the impact site from both angles. And I don't want to enter a cave. Well, actually, I might have to enter a cave. Because, I mean, it's kind of weird to say that this area isn't big, because it's literally two areas, not even portions from multiple areas. It's two areas combined, but it's not that big still, which is probably why they decided to combine the two in development. All right, let me make sure that all Pikmin are accounted for. They should get back in time. But if not, we can supplement the squads. There. And that way, the yellow onion is being fueled. There should be enough time for that. We also got some sprays. It was an all-around great day. I got to explain my theory, because I've been really hyped for this theory. On my way to college every day, I'll kind of talk through episodes, which used to be a common thing, but it's definitely a common habit for me now. And I'll talk through episodes, and this is one that I discovered in the car one day after I went to a magic tournament, and I got really hyped for this because it just makes so much sense. It lines up perfectly, and it kind of explains Olimar's thought process as to why he returned here. Like, he wanted to go back to the final trial, and so he landed directly in the middle of the ring, because he knew that's where it would be. And he figured that because he killed an enemy here, that there wouldn't be any threats there. Just, maybe it's all my headcanon, but I just think it lines up really well, and that so many things just feel intentional. And I love it. They're telling a story without actually telling a story, and that's the best kind. When your imagination gets to fill in the blanks, then you know that the story's truly great. Alright, how many Pikmin did we get today? We got 100? We got exactly, literally, 100 Pikmin today. Exactly 100 Pikmin. That's on the nose. And we lost none! Still lost 149 overall throughout the adventure, but it's better than yesterday, where we lost, like, 60. That's good. I think that by the end of this adventure, we're going... Actually, I don't even think. I know that by the end of this adventure, we are going to have 1,000 Pikmin, which is a good thing. Now, we also need 51 more purples, but that will be another struggle for another day. Some president you are. I just got back from vacation to find out you're on a treasure hunt. Well, don't bother coming home until you found every item on your list. But we don't have a list. We just have what we want to get. Like, we just want to get everything. We want all the treasure. So basically, she's telling him never to come home again. That's what I'm gathering here. I mean, the debt's paid off, but that doesn't mean you're rich, lady. Alright, thank you guys so much for watching. I didn't mean to press save. Normally, I like to fade to black, but whatever. Thank you so much for watching. If you enjoyed today in any capacity, please click like. If you didn't, then drop a comment telling me I could make the next episode so that you would like it. I release new episodes of Pikmin 2 every Tuesday and Thursday. I'm also Let's Playing... I almost said it. I almost said Luigi's Mansion Breath of the Wild. That's a weird spin-off title, and I don't want to talk about what might be in that spin-off title. That'd be odd. But, sure. I'm also Let's Playing Luigi's Mansion Breath of the Wild right now. New episodes of that come out every Monday and Wednesday. It's a blast. It's like Pikmin, but I have no clue what I'm doing, so all of the theories that I come up with, I'm formulating on the spot. So who knows? Maybe in an episode you'll tune in, and my new theory is that Link is actually a Bokoblin from space that is possessing Luigi in Luigi's Mansion. I don't know, but you'll find out. Alright. On that note, I'll see you guys tomorrow. Wait, from all appearances, this is a particularly frightening crevice. The data is horrifying. Courage is one thing, but recklessness is something else. Perhaps we should turn back. Well, if you still wish to enter, keep your daring in check.